Right. Hello everyone. Welcome to the PC seminar. Today we have with us Saket Saurabh from IMSC Chennai and University of Bergen in Bergen. And he'll be talking about FPT approximation for FPT problems. Thank you for offering to give the talk, Saket. Over to you now.
Thanks a lot. Pratibhav, am I audible to everybody?
I guess you're audible.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So please feel free to stop in between any point of time and ask questions. Okay. So let me straight away get to the definition of the kinds of problem we will be looking for. So before I tell the problem, so the input is going to be say some graph problem, because that is what I will be mostly focusing on. And I don't know how to, okay. Okay, so what is the meaning of an alpha approximation for graph problem? For some graph problem, okay. So our input will be g comma k. Parameter is going to be k, and the output is going to be, this is for say minimization problem. Minimization, and alpha is greater than or equal to 1, okay. So if alpha is greater than or equal to 1, then for this, it will be, what will be the output will be either G does not have a solution of size at most K, or a solution of size at most alpha times K, okay? So if I mean by alpha approximations, either I will be outputting to you that it does not have a solution of size at most k, or a solution of size at most alpha k. And if this is for minimization problem, and if it is a maximization problem, then it will be defined for alpha say less than equal to 1. And again, either a solution of size at most size at least k doesn't exist, okay, no solution of size at least k, or no, or output a solution of size at least alpha k. Okay, so either I'm able to tell that this is a no instance, or I'm able to give you a solution which is within alpha factor approximation to the k we have given to you. Okay, so this is the definition which I'm going to use. Since I'm going to stick mostly to a minimization problem, so we can just hold the first definition. So for example, if our problem would have been say vertex cover problem and K, and say alpha is some 1.5, then I'm saying that either I will tell you that there is no vertex cover of size at most K, or I'm going to output your solution of size at most 1.5 K, okay? And for example, if I had a directed feedback vertex set problem, then either I'm going to tell you that there is no directed feedback vertex set of size at most k, or I'm going to output a solution of size at most 1.5 k. Okay, so this is what it will mean. And what kind of running time I'm looking for? I'm looking for a running time of the form f of k times poly in n. Okay, so these are the kind of problems which we will be looking for. And FPT approximation has been in, in vogue, okay, in last 5-6 years. And there are two reasons for it, okay? So let me. There are problems which are W1 hard, or say, let me not call W1 hard, but let's say W hard, okay? For example, dominating set. Click. Independent set. Okay, so these are our classical W hard problem, and a natural question was initiated whether for these problems, if we are not interested in solution of size at most k or at least k, but rather we are happy with even if you give me some FPT approximation. For example, for a click is a maximization problem, we were also happy with if you could give me a click of size say k divided by root k or k divided by some k over log star k, you know, these kind of approximations. So we are happy if you are able to give me a solution which is small, like which is some function of k also, I would be good. But unfortunately, we know much clearer picture of these problems. So for example, for dominating set, what do we know? We know that it has no f of k FPT approximation unless FPT is equal to W1, I think. Yeah, okay. Meaning, I mean, for dominating set, you cannot come up with any function f of k. Like, so for example, your function could be 2 power 2 power dot 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 k, such that I can say either that there is no dominating set of size at most k, or give you a dominating set of size at most 2 power 2 power 2 power k times k. I mean, no such algorithm doesn't exist unless FPT is equal to W1. So we have a very very good inapproximability result for this. We can say similar things about click and independent set, but unfortunately it is under what is called gap ETH. And it is a good open question whether we can have inapproximability under FPT not equal to W, for example. Okay, so this is it. So this is where it motivation came. Then it appeared that okay, for some of these problems, the problems does become inapproximable even if we allow so much of running time. So is it about all the problem, or there are problems which are FPT, though they are W1 hard with some parameter, but they are FPT with respect to FPT approximable with respect to that parameter. Okay, so there are several such problems in literature. But I'll give you one example which I personally like. So for example, let's look at 3-path hitting set. Okay, what is 3-path hitting set? So my input is g comma k, parameter is k, and output is does z have a set of size at most k such that the g has a set of size at most k such that set s of size at most k, so that g minus s has no path as a subgraph on 3 vertices. Okay, so is this problem FPT? Anybody?
Yes, it is.
So you can take a path of 3 and branch, right?
So actually, so by the way, just one quick question. So I think you mean that even a triangle is not allowed, right? That no path even as a subgraph, not just as induced subgraph, right?
No, just as a subgraph.
Yeah, okay.
As a subgraph, it's on purpose written subgraph, not as an induced subgraph. Okay. Okay. So this is simple 3-power k algorithm. But we know this problem is NP hard. Okay. So let me change this problem a bit and let me call it L path hitting. No path the subgraph on say L vertices. And now my parameter is not K and L. What do you think about this problem? Do you think this could be FPT? Why?
So it captures vertex cover also, right? For L equals to 2.
Okay, so L equal to 2, this is vertex cover. Correct, right? So in fact, this problem is para NP hard actually. Okay, let me use this FPT language, right? So forget about W1 hard. This problem is para NP hard. So what does it mean to parameterize this? And it, the problem has a trivial approximation algorithm, right? L approximation, right? Is that clear? Take a path of length L, delete all vertices, and repeat, right? This is the factor L approximation. Okay, now I think SODA 2017, Yu Ling Lee, maybe I'm not writing his name properly. Okay, he gave order log L approximation. Running in time, if I recall correctly, it was some 2 power poly L time poly N. Okay, so he gave order log L approximation.
I will tell you.
Running in FPT time. Okay, so this was a very good example of a problem which could have a very good approximation if we, even if in a parameter with respect to which the problem could be para NP hard. Okay, so this is a very beautiful algorithm, uses all kind of solving LPs but it also uses the FPT property to detect paths of length L and things of this nature. And that is why this algorithm takes such a running time. Okay, so for example, even if I have to detect a path of length L, right, and I need a polynomial time, then you notice that I need some C power L even to just detect whether there's a path of length L or not, right? Because if I'm going to use N to the power L, then that is not FPT at all, right? So this is why naturally FPT in L is the right question to ask for these simple questions, okay? So this was a very good example of a problem which could be as bad as para NP hard with respect to some parameter, but could be useful to have a good approximation algorithm with respect to that as a parameter, okay? So that was a story for, another example is like K-way cut, right? So what is your objective? You want to, given a graph G and K, your parameter is K, and objective is to delete minimum number of edges such that it has at least L, at least K components. And this problem is again W1 hard. And with respect to K, okay? The problem had 2 - 1/K approximation algorithm. And a natural question was, does this problem can be, and it is known that you cannot do better than 2 - epsilon under some hypothesis. I do not remember very well, which I think it was small set expansion. But the question was, can we do very good? So people started to get 2 - epsilon approximation, but FPT in K, and eventually we gave a 1 plus epsilon approximation running in time K over epsilon to the power K polynomial. Okay, so while dominating set, independent set, click are very good example that problems which are W hard are not only W hard, but they are also hard to approximate within FPT time. But L path hitting set parameterized by L or K bay cut parameterized by K are very good examples when the problems, if you allow FPT running time, we can get very good approximation algorithm. So this was a story for a long time or with respect to, so people largely focused on hard problems. But there are problems that are FPT, okay? But there are problems that are FPT, and maybe they could benefit from FPT approximation. So there was some work done in this area. It's not that we were the first to do or something. So for example, look at vertex cover. Okay, the vertex cover has say 1.27 to the power k. I'm not going to write polynomial time algorithm. Okay, now you can ask, can we get a factor 3/2 approximation for vertex cover in time that is significantly better ?1.27k. Okay, so people try to do a branching algorithm for vertex cover who try to take advantage of this fact. For example, you know that if you find a triangle in a graph, then notice that I know that at least two vertices will go into any optimal solution. Then let me take all the three vertices into my solution. Then this is a 3/2 approximation reduction, for example, right? So the moment you allow an approximation, you tend to have much more reductions to your algorithm than before. But let me tell you an interesting simple algorithm which will achieve this. And then I will tell you what recently people have been able to achieve in this area is that for vertex cover, an algorithm which can beat 1.27 to the power k and achieve this is basically you find a maximum matching. Maximum matching, say E1, E2, E1, E2, EL, and EL prime, dot, dot, dot. So basically you pick both endpoints of some L1 edges, right? But what you know, now in the remaining, you have a vertex cover of size K minus L1, because from this L1 endpoints matching edges, you need to at least pick one vertex and you have taken say 2 times L1. Now on the remaining, you will be able to do your algorithm. You just apply the best known approximation algorithm. So then you will be able to get 1.27 K minus L1 algorithm in and produce approximation to L1 plus K minus L1, which is like K plus L1, right? So I think if I substitute L1 equal to say, half, then I will get 1.5. Suppose I substitute L1 equal to K/2, then I will get 1.5 approximation, and this will be better than 1.5 approximation, right? Better than 1.27 approximation. So we can achieve these kind of things with some simple trick that combines poly time algorithm and doing in the part of the instance some the best known FPT algorithm. But in recent paper by Hadas and Ariel Kulik, they achieve much, much better running time. So this is a paper that appeared in Fox 2020. So, okay. So people have done also these kind of results. But if you notice here, going from C power k to much better C power k is an interesting set of question. But another interesting set of question that arises in parameterized complexity is asymptotic. So even in FPT, there are several problems, say FPT, there are several problems that have following complexity. First, some 2 power poly k algorithm or k power k algorithm, right? And for a long time, neither we are able to show some lower bounds or able to improve the running time. Let me say example, tree width, right? We know that it has 2 power big O of k cube algorithm, if I recall correctly, or maybe it is k to the power big O of k cube, okay? Directed feedback vertex set, we know it has a k power k algorithm. Multi-cut in undirected graph has, again, it has some 2 power big O of k cube or k square, I don't remember very well, but it is some 2 power poly k. And we do not know how to improve these algorithms or to even to show lower bound. Secondly, you could have a problem, for example, for which a form of f of k has lower bound under, say, ETH. Example, let's say distortion, right? We know that d power d is a lower bound, right? Click cover. We know that 2 power k is optimal, right? And you could have many such, or even if you are interested in C power k, then for example, base of C is optimal under strong exponential time hypothesis. For example, let's say vertex cover parameterized by tree width. So it has a 2 power tree width. That's a lower bound. So for all these kind of problems, we could ask all kind of questions. For example, the set of questions that we could ask for this and this is that one natural question could be, can we have a C power K algorithm and has order 1 approximation? Okay. Or for example, for DFVS, one could ask, well, is it possible that we can have an 1 plus epsilon approximation, which runs in time C by epsilon to the power k? So, I mean, of course, when epsilon is like 1 over k, this is still k power k. But as a question, all these questions make sense. Similarly, same set of questions make sense in the second form. But for the third, if I have a base of exponent, then I might be interested in getting an 1 plus epsilon approximation, which is like sum 2 minus f of epsilon to the power tree width, for example, for vertex cover. So at least our motivation to start studying these questions, but these set of questions, and another interesting thing which motivated us to look for this problem was the success story of tree width. Okay, so for tree width, we know that exact FPT algorithm has exact FPT algorithm has running time 2 to the power big O of KQ times poly N, okay? But notice for this problem, we know a C power K algorithm, but constant factor approximation, right? And like there were a lot of papers there. There was a k power k with constant factor approximation, and there were a c power k algorithm with order 1 approximation. And in 2013, Fox there was a paper that simultaneously achieved C power K and linear dependence on N. So because I shouldn't be writing poly N here, it's important to write that this is a linear time algorithm. Okay, so, and I think C comp that achieved simultaneously C power K and a linear dependence on input size. Okay, so now a natural question is, can the success of tree width be repeated for other combinatorial problems? Okay, so this is a high level survey of the area and the kind of questions people have asked and the posed. Okay, and in my remaining time, I will fix a problem and give you a concrete ideas of how we go about achieving some of these things. Okay, so unless you have a question, please let me know at this point of time. It's a good time to ask a question before I move into a bit more detailed and technical lecture talk. Any question? Okay. So still, story is not, this is not the way the story was, but let me tell you the kind of challenges we face when we try to, so I will focus on directed feedback vertex set. And multi-cut. So here, input is going to be directed graph, a number k, parameter is k, and the question is, does there exist a set S subset of V of D such that D minus S. Okay, so for this, famously from 2007, we have an algorithm running in time k power k. And now, in fact, we have also algorithm with running time k power k into n plus n. Okay, and we don't know how to get c power k even for planar digraphs. Okay, so this was the state of the art. Now, what we were able to manage to give, we are able to give a C power K algorithm, but it is factor two approximation. Okay. And under some conjecture, not remember correctly, there is no order one approximation in poly time. Okay, so this is a state of the art. And the best known approximation in poly time is order log n, log log n. In fact, this is, I should say log opt, log log opt. Okay, so this is a state of affair and this is our result. Okay, this is our result. This one. Okay, so the other second problem which we study, there are several problems we study, but the second problem which I will focus on, so I will probably start from here, is undirected multicut. So what is an undirected multicut? So input is a graph, pairs S1, T1, S2, T2, SL, TL, and parameter is going to be K, not L, okay? And the question is, does there exist a set F subset of VG such that in G minus S, there is no path from SI to TI? In other words, Okay, so if you delete S and look at the connected component, okay, every component has at most one of SI and TA. Okay, so this is how it is. So this problem was also open for long, long time. And in 2010, two group, Marx plus Razgon, and I think Stephen Thomasy, plus there were some other people who showed that problem is FPT. And the best known algorithm by the running time by Marx and Razgon algorithm is faster, and it runs in time. I don't know what it is. I think this is either 2 or 3. Is MSR there?
Yes, Saket.
Is it 2 or 3?
Oh, it's
K cube.
Huh?
No. Is that your question? Whether it's K cube or K squared?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Multi-cut? So it is now K squared.
Oh, it is K squared. Thanks. Okay. So it is K squared and poly in N. And so for this also, so what we do not improve for exact, but for FPT, we are able to give C power K factor 2 approximation. Okay. So let me give you some high level idea of how do we go about this. Actually, if someone knows these algorithms, it is not very hard, but there are some subtlety. So let me start with an undirected multicut, okay? Okay, I find it slightly more easier to explain. So let me start with this. So I'm going to do an iterative compression. So what are we given? So we are given a solution W, okay? And this is a solution. Need to find solution. That is disjoint from W, okay? This is my upper objective, okay? So we are in a setting where we are given a graph G and a set W also, which is a solution. But in our setting, W could be 2k plus 1, okay? So what will be our invariant? Invariant will be either no solution of size at most k, or return a solution of size at most 2k. Now notice that if I'm able to maintain this invariant, then I'm perfectly happy, right? Because why am I happy if I'm able to do this? Because if I'm able to say that this subinstance does not have a solution of size at most k, it implies that I do not have a solution of size at most k for the whole instance. But if I'm not, then I'm able to give you a solution of size at most 2k for this small instance, then I can again add another vertex, get a solution of size 2k plus 1, and perform my compression step, okay? So this is a basically an approximation version of the compression step, nothing more than that, okay? So let's believe that this is what we would like to solve. And let me tell you, I know I have like taken away a lot of things who do not know iterative compression, but at least this part of the talk, let me tell the idea which the people who know iterative compression will be able to follow and understand. Okay, otherwise I will be doing all the basics till then. Okay, so suppose this is a setting, and the people who do not know iterative compression, suppose that this is the problem which we are interested in solving. And trust me, if we are able to solve this problem, then we will be able to solve the problem eventually. Okay, so now I'm looking for a solution, say no, this is a bad color. Z. Okay. Now I want to see what happens after I delete Z. I deleted Z. What am I going to get? I'm going to get connected components. Okay. And what is the property of these connected components? W might break into W1, W2, W3, dot, 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 W, say L, W, maybe not L, W, some set, WQ, okay? Maybe there could be a component which has no W, okay? So this is how things could look like. And what about SI and TI? What about SI and TI? Can there be some SI and TI in some same component after it deletes Z? No, because Z is supposed to be my solution for my multicut problem of size at most K, okay? Suppose now that cardinality of W1 is equal to cardinality of W2 and is equal to cardinality of WQ is equal to 1. Then what can we say about Z? Right? So then my claim is Z is a multi-way cut. Z is a multi-way cut of size at most K for W1, W2, WQ. And what is a multi-way cut? Multi-way cut is basically a set of vertices that intersects all path between two vertices of a set, okay? So say terminal set, okay? So basically, if I give you a terminal T, okay? Multi-way cut is nothing but set of vertices after you delete, there is no path between these two. So it's a simpler version of multi-way cut, multi-cut, okay? So like in multi-cut, I give you pairs. In multi-way cut, I give you a subset of terminals and say, cut every path between this pair of vertices. For example, if I take terminal equal to all the vertex set, it is nothing but a vertex cover problem, okay? So notice that Z becomes a multi-way cut for this W1, W2, W3, WQ. But I have told you that I know that W1, W2, WQ is equal to 1. So now first let's see how we can get to this point. And that's very easy. Okay, what do I know? I know that W will distribute. I guess the distribution. Okay, I guess the distribution, meaning I guess the partition of W into W1, W2, W2, 3, dot, 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 WQ. Okay, how many such partitions are there? Well, it is some K to the power big O of K, right? Because, I mean, 2K vertices cannot get partitioned into more than 2K parts, right? So this is what I can guess. So this is where you will incur K to the power A, order K time. But now you have this W1, W2, WQ. Now, what will I do? I will say, fine. Let me identify these vertices into one. And what is the meaning of identifying these vertices? So suppose W1 was W1, W11, W21, say WA1, you delete W1, add a new vertex, and make it adjacent to all the neighbors of W1, okay? So I delete this and this. So basically now I have identified into W1, W2, and WQ, okay? So now I have identified. And what do I know about this? Z is a solution of size at most k. Z is a multi-way solution of size at most k. So first thing what I do is I find a multi-way cut for my terminal set W1, W2, WQ. Okay? I find any multi-way cut, okay? And also, they should not include W1, W2, WQ. And this is very easy. Like, think of this way, that if I'm looking for a solution of size K, I give W1 to WQ weight of size K plus one. And that I can achieve by making several copies of W1 and giving the same neighborhood. So for now, let's believe that this can be done, okay? So in fact, I can find such a solution in time 2 power k, okay? Now, what can I say if I do not find a solution of size, if I don't find a multi-way cut of size at most k? I can say no, immediately. Because if this is a correct partition, then my solution is going to be a multi-way cut for this W1 to WQ. So if I'm saying, give me any multi-way cut, and if my solution says, hey, it does not have a multi-way cut of size at most k, I can immediately say no. Otherwise, it returns me some say s. Now let's, so this is a payment which I have done. So what did I achieve after deleting s? Okay, so now I have deleted S. I have components which contains, each of them can be contain at most one. Maybe there are components which does not have anything. Okay, now my question is, suppose here's a component with no WI. Can they have some pair SITI? Anybody?
No.
Why?
Because W was a solution, right?
Exactly. So if this connected component contained some path, some SITI, this is a connected component, then it is a path from SI to TI, and disjoint from W, but W was a solution. Right? So these components are free of SITI, we shouldn't bother, okay? Now let's concentrate on a component which contains some WI, okay? Focus. So now we focus on a component. Okay, now let's look at the pairs. Some, maybe there is some SA, TA, SB, TB inside this component. SP, TP, okay? What do you know about this WI? The moment I deleted WI, okay? Because look, after I deleted everything else, right, nothing happened. But now look at this WI. What is the property of SI and WI? Well, the property of this is that if I deleted the set of vertices WI, then all these pairs will be disconnected. Am I right? Now, but what I know about this, it means, but I know that WI is not going to the solution. So what is this question? I know that, look at, there's a path from SI to this WI, and there's a path from TA. Either you have to disconnect, the only way to disconnect SA from TA is either killing paths from SA to WI or killing paths from TA to WI. Okay, similarly with SBTB, SPTP. Does this remind you of any problem? So if you recall correctly, there's a problem in which has been studied recently quite a lot, which is called digraph pair cut. What is a digraph pair cut problem? This is precisely digraph pair cut problem. So input is a directed graph, a source vertex, and some, say, x1, y1, x2, y2, xp, yp, and parameter is k. And the question is, do we have a set S subset of VD such that subset of VD such that in D minus S, S does not have path to both XI, YI in any pair. Meaning, if I delete this set S, then S could have path to one of the vertices in the pair, but not to both. So I'm only interested in disconnecting S to one of these guys. And this problem has an algorithm with running time 2 power k. This is just basically branching, but branching on a closest cut or something of this nature. So now what I'm going to do on each of this component, I'm going to run this digraph pair cut algorithm. How? By taking each S and making making path in both ways. Okay. Now I know that locally I'm going to get opt, but what I'm going to get is a local opt, which is the best solution I could have got. Similarly in each component. So in the second stage, in each component, I have only spent solutions, which is at most k. So now this is why it's a factor two approximation, because I have spent factor k to first partition these WIs, and then I have paid another k to break each connected component using this digraph pair cut algorithm. Okay, but if you notice, this algorithm is k power k. Okay, and you need to do a lot of hard work to make this algorithm c power k and a factor two approximation. So the kind of ideas we need, I think that is best explained for the directed feedback vertex set. So let me go to the directed feedback vertex set and tell you the kind of ideas we are going to use there. Okay, so let me go to directed feedback vertex set. Okay, so I'm again in the directed feedback vertex set. I'm just going to disjoint feedback vertex set problem. We are given a solution F, and this is our DAG, okay? Objective, to find a solution such that it is disjoint from S. Okay, and how does the algorithm works? The algorithm works the following way. You find permutation of S, okay? And then you basically disconnect all the paths from, suppose I take a permutation of S, and this is, so you cut all paths from this vertex to everybody else, then from this vertex to everybody else. So this is what is called skew symmetric cut, right? So basically I have found a permutation, and look at the last vertex in this permutation. I kill all the paths from the last vertex to everybody else, second last vertex to everybody else, so on and so forth. And using important separator, this step can be carried out in time 4 power k. And this is why the running time of this algorithm is 4 power k times k factorial, okay? So we are just going to take this part of the algorithm, and I'm going to tell you how we are going to translate this into a factor two approximation algorithm, okay? So, of course, we can't guess the permutation. Okay? But what I'm going to guess is, this is a natural approach which all of us, I'm sure, have tried in past. You guess two equal halves. What I mean by this, so I have this S, I said, look, this is S1 and this is S2. All the vertices in S1 is going to appear before all the vertices in S2. All vertices in S1 going to appear before S2. This is the only thing which I'm going to ask you, okay? Not going to bother about the permutation within S1, permutation within S2. But if even if I have guessed this, what else do I know? I know all paths from S1 to S2 must be killed. Okay? Okay, so now we focus on this part and we try to achieve this at some cost. So how? What is the cost we are going to incur? So now we are going to focus here. This is my S1, this is my S2. And what I know that suppose I had a solution, say directed feedback vertex set, which is disjoint from here. Let's call this solution F, okay? Now what I know that F will contain some F hat in S, in F, say minimal, that cuts all S1, S2 paths, right? Because F cuts all the paths in that order. So it definitely kills all the paths from S1 to S2. It's like some subset, and this is a minimal subset. Okay, so now I'm going to do two things. Guess the size of F hat. Okay, so suppose this is I, okay? Now, what I'm going to do is, I don't know how, like, I don't know what to do with F, how to get this F hat, but I'm going to do the following thing. So here is S1, here is S2, okay? I'm going to say, let's look at a separator that is closest to S1 and that is closest to S2, okay? So I'm not going to find one separator, but two separator of size I. So now I will have two separators, okay? Here. But look, how many separators? Look, this notion of closest is defined on the separator subside at most I, and closest is same as saying the separator which is farthest. And by important separator property, number of separator is 4 to the power i, okay? So suppose, so I'm going to go over all possible 4 to the power i separators of this here and 4 to the power i separators here. So the branching will be of 4 to the power 2i. But now what happens if I do this? Then I claim, so look, after I have deleted this vertices, okay? Definitely there is no path from S1 to S2 because after all, I have taken two separators, say X1 and X2. X1 is a S1, S2 separator. X2 is a S1, S2 separator, right? So definitely after I have deleted X1 union X2, no path from S1 to S2. So now my problem has become disjoint in the sense that now all I need to do is kill all the paths within S2. So this is one problem. I need to kill all the paths between S1. That's my another problem. So they are disjoint problem. I'm going to solve them recursively all by themselves. But I have to do one thing, okay? How much did I pay for this, right? I paid 2i, okay? So I knew that the optimum paid I vertices from S1 to S2, I am going to pay 2i, okay? But Have I decreased my solution by I? Meaning, in D minus x1 union x2, k drops to k minus I. If this is the case, then I have a very good recurrence and I will be able to get C power k algorithm. But the hard part is, how are we going to show that indeed my solution has dropped by I vertices? Okay, and this is where this notion of closest will help. Okay, so what, how I'm going to show this? I will show this. Great. So I'm going to show that f minus f hat is a solution of d minus x1 union x2. If I show that f minus f hat is a solution of d minus x1 union x2, then indeed I do have a solution of size k minus I, right? It means I had dropped a solution of size at most this. Okay. Now, suppose not. What is the meaning of suppose not? It means there is, say, a cycle that uses a vertex of f hat. So let's say this is my s1, this is my s2, and this was some vertex, some x. Okay. And now suppose I have a cycle. So first thing, let's ask ourselves, this cycle, whatever this cycle is going to be, can this contain vertices from both S1 and S2? Well, no, because if it contains this, then there's a path from S1 to S2, but at least you are guaranteed that X1, X2 is a separator from S1 to S2, right? So definitely it cannot contain, this cycle cannot contain vertices from both S1 and S2. So either it contains, and why will it contain a solution, a vertex from S1 or S2? Because S was a solution, okay? That is why. Now notice, so it contains only vertices from either S1 or S2. So the picture looks like this. So picture is, going to be, okay, like this. X has to be on this, okay? Now, let's look at this path. So suppose this is a vertex S. Look at this path, S to X, okay? Look at the path S to X. What did we do? So this is a part, so suppose, look at your F hat. Look at your F hat. And what did you delete? You deleted one separator X1, which is closest to S1. What is the meaning of closest to S1? X1 is a separator whose size is same as F hat, and its reachability set is smaller than is properly contained in the reachability set of F hat, which implies that any path that will reach, that any path that, that any path from S1 to F hat is also hit by X1, okay? So in particular, this implies that S to X path cannot exist. If S to X path cannot exist, it means we have shown that this cycle cannot exist. And we have shown that F hat is a separator of size. F hat is like, F hat does not participate into any directed cycle. If F hat doesn't participate into any directed cycle, it means for the reduced instance, the solution is of size K minus I, okay? So I did not go into the important separators and this, but only thing which you have to know is that you fix me a size, then I will give you, so you fix a size and you fix a separator in your head, okay? Then there is a separator in my instance which kills all the path from this set. So what I mean is this, so you start with some S1 and you have some set in your head, okay? Then I'm going to produce a family of separators with the following property. There is one says that it is also a separator of X. It is a separator X S1 separator. So now if an number of such objects is just, suppose it is a 4 to the power 5 of X1, then we are happy because all that we wanted is that for this F hat, I have a set, which is also a a f hat s1 separator, which it is. So, and in particular, the if you take a closest separator to s1, like all possible, enumerate all possible closest separator to s1 of this particular size, then that family has this property. Okay, so this is all that we needed to use here. And once you have this, what happens is that now notice that in recursively solution, you might have size of f hat might be one or two, but how did you make progress? Well, the progress is made because if you think of s1, s2 as like 2k and your solution as k, and think of a measure as like 3k, then in every recursive step, you are losing by good fraction, at least some part of the measure. And so basically what happens is that if you have a tk less than equal to some 1000 to the power, 10,000 to the power k into 0.9k, for example, okay, then this is going to be some c power k, right? This is a geometric series, okay? So some c power k, you can show this is some c to the power k. So here my mu is going to be size of w plus my size of the solution. So recursively, this is what I'm going to do. And we can show that, and each time, what happens? At this point of time, my solution needed to take I vertices, I paid two I vertices. And hence at the end, I'm going to look at the, all the branches and going to pick up the branch, which has a minimum size, and going to do this. And this is why this approach is called two extreme separator approach, because what did we do? Once we had this S1, S2, right? We took separator, which were extreme, like which one which was closest to S2, one which was closest to S1. And this allowed us to argue that, hey, you have reduced your optimum solution also by some. We need more sophisticated, slightly more sophisticated argument of this extremal separator to be applied to the multicut algorithm, which I gave you, or k power k, to get a factor two approximation. But this is an idea which seems, this is idea of this two extremal separator seems to work for many other problems like subset DAVS, directed OCT, and it yields a c power k approximation algorithm and gives you a factor two approximation. And so at this point of time, so this is all that I wanted to tell you, the technical part. If you are interested, you can go and look at the paper. So some open problems, if I have to mention, is can we beat two? Because somehow two seems to be inherent to this approach. Even better question, can we have an one plus epsilon approximation for DFVS or multicut, which is like C over epsilon to the power K? I mean, this will not contradict anything, and maybe, at least, maybe it will give us some more insight, and that could lead to a C power K algorithm. Yeah, so, okay. So now that could be use some of these ideas to get, say, for example, lossy kernel for DAVS. Again, say even factor two lossy kernel, or maybe factor 1000 lossy kernel, no idea. Another problem which I find quite interesting is planar vertex deletion. It has a k power k algorithm, but can we have, say, order one approximation in c power k time? Caudal vertex deletion, again k power k, can we have an order one approximation in c power k time, or even better, in poly time? But let's start with c power k time. So I think there are some interesting questions which I personally like to think about them. And I don't know whether they are hard or easy. I mean, I have no idea. It's just that we have spent some time, but not a lot, to make any judgment about these things. Okay, so I think I'm done. I already am 5 minutes over my time. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Saket. Now we'll open for questions. If you have any questions, just unmute yourselves and ask.
Anybody?
When you remove x1 and x2,
yes,
the two instances that you're getting are not truly disjoint, right? In the like in the sense of vertex disjointness.
They may not be, but in terms of what you need to kill, they are disjoint. Okay. No. They will be disjoint. Because look, you don't have path. You don't have path from S1 to S2, right?
Yes, but you can have path from S2 to S1, right?
You can have a path from S2 to S1. Yes, you could have path from S2 to S1. That's true.
Okay. So you have to do some additional work to create this instances so that this.
It's not much.
Not having. Okay.
You still have to guess the budget of the two instances, and that will help you. So even if you overdid in the sense that you picked up the same solution vertices in both places, you might be even better. You get my point? So you don't do anything. You just take S1 and S2 and say, look, to kill the paths internally, I need K1 vertices. To kill the paths internally, K2 vertices, right? Because the set of vertices which are going to kill these paths will not be able to kill the paths of the other side.
So, but when you're using this important separator property, so recursively also you will use that, right? So
of course.
Won't that cause a problem?
No, because major
because
changes,
then
right?
Now it is
so, yes?
Yes. You were saying something?
Yeah,
no,
audio was gone.
Saket, if I may.
Yes,
so,
go ahead.
Akansha. So once you remove these two separators, right? So if you look at the subproblems, you're only interested in the strongly connected components, of course, non-trivial
yes.
strongly connected components. And
okay.
the non-trivial
okay.
strongly connected components of these two problems will definitely be disjoint.
Disjoint.
Okay, thanks.
Any more questions?
Okay, maybe it was too fast. Yeah. Okay, then I guess.
Yeah, I don't see any more questions. So I guess we can wrap up. So, all right. Thank you, Saket, once again. Thank you so much for the talk. It was really good to have you. And thanks to the audience for being with us. So that's it for today. See you all next week. Thank you. Bye.